YPO, WPO, Kingfisher, Diggy Palace Hotel, our venue partner, Rambagh Palace Hospitality Partner, Inaugural Dinner, Le Meridian Hospitality Partner, Writers Ball, Lux Amer Hotel, Music Stage Partner, Indigo Domestic Airline Partner, Uber Mobility Partner, Penguin Random House, Nestle, IQ, the Indian Quarterly, our media partners, Patrika Group, Red FM, Dainik Bhaskar, DNA, Twitter, and Royal Treasure for all the lovely furniture that we see on stage. Hello. Yeah. Just to let you know, all our authors will be available for book signing, so grab your copy from the bookshop, the festival bookshop, and they'll be signing it for you after the session, right outside the venue, at the book signing area. Quick few house rules before we begin. Please keep your mobile phones in silent mode, and in case you still need to use, make a call, please go outside the venue and let's not disturb anyone. Do not litter, let's keep our festival clean. Please take your litter with you. We've got waste paper baskets all over the venue, please use them, throw it there. And please look after your belongings, we are not responsible for any loss. Thank you very much. Welcome to the 9C Jaipur Literature Festival at Baithak. We are delighted to introduce bilingualities. Yoko Tawada, Cornelia Funke, Abdul Rahmane Waberi, Ira Pandey in conversation with Mohini Gupta. This session is presented by Rajasthan Patrika Series.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Okay, so good morning, everyone, and welcome to this session on bilingualities. I'm really excited for today's session because I'm going to be discussing my absolutely favorite topic with some of the most fascinating names that I've come across. I'll do a quick round of introduction and then we can start our discussion. I'll start from Ira Pandey. She is a writer, editor, and award-winning translator. She has been the managing editor of DK Books and the chief editor at Rodi. Did I get it right? Okay. Moving on to Abdul Rahman Waberi. He's a French Djiboutian writer. He also teaches French at the George Washington University. Cornelia Funke. I got that right. Funke. Cornelia Funke. She's a German writer of children's fiction, and she's most popularly known for her Inkheart trilogy. Okay. So should I pick that up?
I think that's better.
Yeah. Yes. And we have Yoko Tawada, who writes in Japanese and in German. She's written short stories, a novel, and has won many awards. So I'm going to move on to our discussion on bilingualities. To start with, I wanted to start off with a short poem that I feel I could really connect to as a bilingual myself. I speak Hindi and English. And in India, English has many connotations. It has many sort of we aspire to speak English, but we also sort of have this conflicting colonial relationship with English. And there's this short poem by this Cuban scholar. It's called Dedication, and it goes, "The fact that I am writing to you in English already falsifies what I wanted to tell you. My subject, how to explain to you that I don't belong to English, though I belong nowhere else, if not here, in English." So I'm going to start off with that thought and just get thoughts from all of you about this concept of a mother tongue. Because for us, it's a very conflicting relationship of speaking our mother tongue, but also being educated in, say, a colonial language. But I'm not sure how each one of us relates to it. So can we start with you, Ira, and just talking about your relationship with your mother tongue?
Okay. I was fortunate in that I grew up in the place that I was born, which is our native area of Kumaon. And I spent the first few years in Kumaon, and so I spoke and heard Kumaoni, and that is now what I think is my mother tongue. However, as in most Indian homes, we spoke English and Hindi. But to date, when I meet my sisters or an aunt or somebody who's connected with my childhood, I only speak either in Kumaoni or in English. So Hindi is really my father tongue in that sense, that because I belong to India and Hindi is our national language. I'm more comfortable either in Kumaoni or in English. However, since Kumaoni is not an official language and is considered a dialect, I have now started working in Hindi and English, and I translate from Hindi into English. What I want to say is that my story is not dissimilar from the stories of perhaps all of you who belong to India. We all have at least three languages in us, if not more. And because we keep moving from one state to another, we pick up smatterings of other languages which enrich our vocabulary. The other thing I want to point out is that because our languages have come from an oral tradition, we use sense perceptions and sounds and smells in a very special way. And I find that becomes a huge handicap when I'm talking in English, for instance, where it sounds very false if I write exactly the way that I think. I'd like to hear from the other panelists whether their experiences are different from ours.
Would you like to?
Yeah. Good evening, morning. I don't know if I'm good.
Yeah,
am I heard? Okay. I first want to thank my fellow colleagues, Ira, Cornelia, Yoko, and yourself. And I want to also thank you for being here in this morning. And I'm also very grateful to the people who invited me, the festival, the Institute, the French Institute. Dorothée is here present. So it's a pleasure to be in this Jaipur festival, which I heard a long time ago many things about. And now it's happening. So, and this is actually also my first discussion in Jaipur. Coming to the question of language, I think that what Ira was saying is very similar to my case. And also, I'm actually here learning from Indians, because in India you have many languages, many religions, many sub-languages and dialects. So it's really a mainstream, maelstrom of languages and culture. And I just want to, maybe if, when I go back to the US and France, to take a few things about what I heard and what I felt. And having said that, I come from a very colonial culture. And, Djibouti, my tiny country of birth, has been the latest French colony to be decolonized in 1977. And I was at such schooled only in French. I'm a byproduct of what I call the fabulous school in the tradition of the French, of Jules Ferry, which means that I learned everything French, and I haven't learned so much thing from the local languages. And in the case of Djibouti, we have two local languages, Afar and Somali, which is my mother tongue. And we also have Arabic coming from the Yemen, because we are just across Yemen. And we also have some flavors of Indian flavors that come by the way of Mumbai, but this is another story. Anyhow, I only conceptualize and I only write in French. And now I also teach in English, but English is only my third or my fourth language, so it's something that came further afterwards. So my first emotional language is Somali, but I'm unable to write Somali because I was not schooled in Somali. And I think that the language in which we write is maybe the language in which we think and felt conceptualize. So I'm 50 years old now, and I'm waiting maybe some years more again to be able to write what might be a very modest poem in Somali. And I have made this promise to someone. I say maybe I will write one day in Somali, but it still is not coming. And I actually have made my home the French. So French is my home. There were a discussion previously in which we were, are you comfortable? Are you conflicting? I'm not either comfortable or not conflicting. French is my home in terms of my work as a literary spirit. So this is the way it is for me right now.
Thank you. I'm going to come back to discussing that in the next question. You. Cornelia, can you talk about that?
Well, I think I probably am the only one in this round who doesn't have a colonial association.
Okay, does it? Okay. I guess I'm the only one in this round who doesn't have a colonial association.
Me either.
Yeah, but Japan, I think, nevertheless has colonial experiences with the English language in the 19th century. When the Americans came to Japan?
We didn't.
So you would not feel like it was an intrusion? Like
we didn't learn English.
Okay, so wrong association. So for me, it was that German kept me in the country I was born in, but English was the golden key to the world. So when yesterday, for example, I talked to Indian children, and they said to me, Cornelia, you are our childhood. I thought, what a magical thing that could happen because of my translation into English. When I was just a German author, I did not have that connection to the world. So for me, English is a love affair and not something, as you say, that estranges me from what I feel and what to express. I still mainly write in German, though. I only dare to write short story. But now in English.
So Japan was closed, had no contact with other countries for over 200 years. And after that, but in during that time, we learned Western sciences through the Dutch languages, and after that, German languages. It was in the history, it was no colonial association because Japan was not colony, but it was a free choice, I say. So the German language is, to me, the private choice. I don't write in English. English does not mean to me. It's just a language for communication. I'm happy that I can speak a little bit English. When I'm in India, I can communicate with people, but nothing else. And my choice is German and Japanese. And I'm interested in compare the concept of two languages that are very different. So I can think about words or like freedom, for example, that does not exist in Japanese, and what does it mean, and ask questions. And so it's very important for me to have at least two languages to write. But it has nothing to do with English language.
And continue with you right now and just ask you have this really interesting
is that okay? Yeah. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. You have this really interesting piece on a multilingual web.
Yeah.
And in that you sort of talk about a person who learns another new language, and that's what and that's what you've done. You've learned a new language, German, and now you write fluently in it.
Yeah.
So I wanted to ask you, and you mentioned this very interesting comparison where you say a person who speaks different languages almost has different personalities, or does he not? And you sort of ultimately talk about a web, an intricate web, where we become sort of interconnected with these languages. So I wanted to ask you, do you feel like we acquire a different personality when we learn another language?
Yes and no. In my first year in Germany, I felt I am two persons, so the Japanese person and the German-speaking person. But but then you make the new experience, emotional experiences in the new languages, and also the two concepts of philosophy are coming together, and you develop your own private philosophy that is made by many languages, or two languages or more. So in the most of us in the new world, we have the personality that is not influenced only by one language, but more than two languages. And it's maybe one person, one multilingual personality.
Ira, would you like to sort of comment on that?
You know, when you were asking that question, I was reminded of a novella that I translated. It is written by one of our most well-known Hindi writers, Manohar Shyam Joshi. And the character, the central character, is this village teacher who lords it over the rest of the village because he knows English. And he walks around the village with the Oxford English Dictionary clamped under his armpit. When he meets this young man who's visiting the village, he's a little threatened because that young man knows more English and is more literate than he is. And he strolls into this young man's room one day and watches him sprawled on his bed with just his pajamas and a singlet on his torso, reading an English novel. And he says, "How can you read an English novel lying like that? You should be wearing trousers and a shirt and a tie sitting at a table." Well, that's exactly what I thought Mohini's question was about, that you do actually change your persona. And particularly in India, where we are now at a cusp where we are outgrowing our colonial past, I mean, we are no longer in awe of the white man's language, and yet we want to acquire it. All over, if you drive through our small towns, the most visible signage will be learn English, computer classes, you know. So the digital age has done what 150 years of education was unable to accomplish, has jump-started a whole generation. What English they are learning, how they are speaking is a different matter. I mean, that's a language which is in the process of being born. But this very interesting collision between cultures and languages and mind processes is what interests me now. I think that is the next step that we have to be really looking at.
In fact, that's also almost problematic because I remember this interview, there's this actor called Nawazuddin Siddiqui, an Indian actor, who was once asked by a journalist, "Did you have problems getting into the film industry because you don't know English?" And he said, "English is just a language, it's not a test of your intelligence." Because it's really almost become
absolutely
like that, it's almost become a test of your intelligence. So actually I want to ask both of you, since you talked about that when you were talking about this language that you grew up speaking in school and the language that you grew up speaking at home. And there's a Kenyan scholar, Gukiwa Thiong'o, who writes a lot about this, about the disconnect that a child feels because your emotional language at home is something else that you speak with your parents, with your family, but in school you're learning about, you know, animals that don't, flowers that don't exist in your country, or animals that don't, you know, exist in your country. So did
Jeez,
you...
A giraffe.
Yeah. So Abdurrahman, did you feel that disconnect while growing up?
Yeah, and actually, I have to confess, Ngugi is a good friend, a kind of mentor, and a, what we call in African, an old brother. I used to teach in Southern California, where actually Cornelia is based, I believe. And Ngugi teach at Irvine, which is an hour drive. And I used to teach in the Claremont College, so I used to drive and
that's very close,
and yeah, have a chat with the old brother Ngugi. And Ngugi was making the case and explaining to me again and again that I have to, actually the person I promised to write a poem for was Ngugi. But it's complicated for me because Ngugi explained intellectually to me what is a loss of a language and a culture. But coming to my own person, I don't feel that way, right? And because, or let's say maybe I'm enough schizophrenic that I don't feel the pain. You see what I mean? What I'm saying is that the ways in which I work in this world is in French, literally. So I can explain and say, well, when I talk to my mom, I only speak Somali, and we don't speak in French, and so on and so forth. But it doesn't really I don't feeling the need to write really because of if I were, I'm not getting emotionally the point, what I lost. I can say everything I have to say to my mom in Somali, and then when I write, I'm someone else. I'm someone who has been reading, I don't know, Dumas or Flaubert or Kenzaburo Oe and so on and so forth. And it's a different person, it's a different even constituency. Someone was saying that we the world comes to us in languages and in translation. When you read a Chinese or a Japanese writer, I read all in French mostly, or in English, but let's say mostly in French. So it's there is no connection between that writer in my African language. So it's different world, and I don't feel really necessary a kind of loss or kind of something I'm missing. Oftentimes in French they say, do you dream in Somali or in French? I don't think I dream in languages, maybe I dream in images.
One question of mine has gone there.
So right now I just feel at ease with this language called French, and that's fine. I'm schizophrenic enough to make my home there, and I don't feel yet some necessity or some urgency to go back to Somali.
No, I relate to that completely, because until a few years ago, even I had read Hindi writers in English translation, because that's just the language that, you know, we read and stuff. Cornelia, I wanted to ask you in relation to that. So like I said, growing up, I've read Hindi writers in English, but do you find a difference in Germany? Because you write in German, and is there enough of a young audience reading in German, or do you find that there's a move towards reading in English?
No, the German audience I have, which is of course children and young adults often, they all read in German first. But most Germans learn to speak English quite fluently from the age of 10. And it's interesting, I once heard from a language coach that she said to me that the language always brings the emotional memories of the time when you learn that language. So in my case, German brings me the first 10 years of my life. Whereas English starts at the age of 10. And sometimes when I write in English, I feel more free. I feel as if I can forget about the past, I can forget about where I came from. It's almost as if I can reinvent myself in that language. And for example, I learned Italian at the age of 25. And when I speak Italian, I feel very different. That is, of course, also Italian makes you feel very different. But the other thing is I'm starting to learn Spanish because half of Los Angeles speaks Spanish. And my best friend is Cuban. And once again, all my Spanish friends say, oh, you're different when you speak Spanish. So yes, I think I have multiple personas by now, but I wish I could have more.
Yoko, I wanted to ask you as well about the audiences in German and Japanese. What is the sort of different experiences that you've had interacting with both of them?
Yes. And I, before that, I want to say you were talking about the images in the dreams. It's very interesting because I think that we must translate anyway the images or the emotions into language, no matter if it's mother tongue or not, because emotion is not equal to the language, and also the images, they don't. So translation is, for me, similar to writing. And also in writing in Japanese is, to me, a kind of translation.
Yeah. That's very interesting. And yes. Your experiences with the audiences that you were...
As I told you, the German language is quite different from Japanese language. You know, the German is related to all European languages, also to Hindi and Marathi and so on. So there are so many differences. Also, the associations. You have the, for example, you have the word "cell" in English. It's "zelle" in German. It's you have them in body. But there is also monk's cell or prison cell, the small rooms. And so I had in German language, suddenly the association that I have many prison cells in my body. It's some surprising images come to us when you learn the exotic languages. And that I love in my writing.
And it's beautiful that you write about, you know, when you learn English, you realize that there was an evening and a night, as opposed to just one time of the day that you were. So you're wondering if you suddenly had more time in a day. Can you tell us a little more about that piece? Because I wish you could share it with the audience. It's really beautiful.
You thought the earth's ending later.
Okay, or we can come back to that. Ira, I'm going to come to you about translation.
Yes.
Because you've, you know, translated from Hindi into English. So what is the most difficult thing that you've found about translation?
You know, what I find most difficult in translation is direct speech. I can deal with indirect speech and with descriptions and long passages which are not conversations. But when it comes to conversations, I feel completely defeated, because in Hindi we have three ways, as in French. Tu, vu, we say tu, tum, up. Now, when in English it's only you. Nobody uses thou anymore. And it makes a huge difference to the pitch of your language when you're trying to homogenize a way of addressing. Also, Hindi is, as you know, it's not a single language. It is a convergence of many dialects and folk speeches in that area, in the North Indian area. So you have words which have crept in from other parts of the, of that land, but which are now completely comprehensible in what is officially Hindi. The trouble when I go, you know, there is a sweetness in some, there is a roughness in some, your rural and urban background comes across in your speeches. Now, these are the nuances which one has to struggle with. And that is why I try and stay away from fiction translations. I've tried a lot of non-fiction initially to get my hand into it. I'm now trying, but I really don't know whether one can do justice and whether one ought to, because you are then not being able to give the full flavor of the book that you're trying to, and it's an insult or somewhere, you know, a defeat at the hands of language. And it's there inside you, but how to get the words and how to get those sense impressions. For instance, in my language, in Kumaoni, we have a very highly developed olfactory sense of smell. And there are at least 10 or 12 words which can describe different kinds of aromas and stinks, depending on what the range of the word is. Now, it has one word in my language, it has a whole phrase in another, perhaps a whole page in another. So, you know, it's difficult to negotiate the spaces between languages. That is what I feel is my biggest problem when I translate.
Would anyone else sort of like to come in on that? Abdul Rahman, even speaking while translation or?
It's really a complicated issue. I remember when I was a student, I'm trying, striving and toiling and doing everything my best on my what we call version and temp. And then the teacher was giving my papers and saying, oh, this is not the author I'm writing. For example, if it's Flaubert, this is not neither Flaubert nor, maybe it's a Waberi, he was used to say. I said, thank God. So it was really difficult, and you're making my day when you say that. In your language, you have 12 verbs to say. It's really what I'm making. So just mastering the language, when you're using the language as an artistic tool, it's so big a business that I cannot even dream of translating something else. You know, I'm just trying to master that beast called French language and making my own tool. And as I was saying, the point I was making to Googie was not only I'm trying to strive and master my language, but French is also the way in which I get the other, the world, there's the other languages, you know, Spanish, German, Hindi, and all those books come to me by way of French language. So this is also a point that I cannot go beyond, even if I would like to, if I have a nationalistic agenda. So far we don't have Somali, Shakespeare is not available in Somali, to the best of my knowledge, so that French is for me that canal. So, and I will finish just saying that I keep paying tribute to a translator, because these are the people who are really making the world one. And just remember, I sometimes say my students who are just, you know, young Americans, they believe that everything was available in English. And they say, come on. You know, yeah. They think that the original writer write it in English, right? And say, come on. So translated as the pillar of the society, and our society.
It's like this person in Kerala, the state in India, who was asked who his favorite writer was, and he said, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, favorite Malayali writer. I guess, and like you said, that's how you could connect with Indian audiences, because of English, because of translation.
And for me, the difference, for example, working in English or working in German is that in German is a much more formal language. And English has an everyday casualness, even when you read Shakespeare. The everyday life is in there. We have a very beautiful translation of Shakespeare, a German one, but it's much more formal. So when I, for the first time, read the original Shakespeare, I was absolutely stunned. It was a very, very different life speaking to me. And when I write dialogue especially, I find it much harder often in German to not get too heavy or to not get sentimental. In English, it's so easy to say, I love you. It means so many different things. In German, ich liebe dich has much more weight and a very different taste to it. And sometimes I yearn for that taste and for the heaviness and the formality. And sometimes I want the casualness, so it is wonderful. I wish I could speak 40 languages. I know people who speak 40 languages fluently and learn one just by working for 2 days in a hotel. I wish I had that ability. I very much envy that.
And Yoko, I also wanted to ask you, you've said somewhere that you love playing with words and jumbling up words and just having fun with it. So have you ever attempted, or will you ever attempt, a bilingual novel?
I'm not sure the concept of the bilingualism. Because if you know two languages, the relationship to one language is never the same as the relationship to other languages. It's personal biography thing. To me, Japanese is my mother tongue. I spoke only Japanese. And when I was 22 years old, I moved to Germany. So, but it's a good thing about that two languages, that the relationship are not the same. Because in the mother tongue is something that you didn't choose. You know, you are born into the language, you had no choice. And the childhood, your childhood is such a richness for the literature, but you are the childhood and the language, your language that you spoke to your mother are in the same space, so you can't write about it from the outside. And when I moved to Germany, I wrote about my childhood in German language, and I felt free, like you maybe, yeah? You are not the part of your world, of your parents and tradition, but you are independent. You must discover your own language, even if you are not bilingualist, you must find your own language that is not a part of your childhood. So otherwise you can't write the literature.
I think in India we've reached a great space where we've combined all the languages that we speak. So I mean, I can't say my language is either Hindi or English. I'm going to say Hinglish because I can conveniently switch from whichever language whenever I want. So Ira, I actually wanted to talk about that.
I found what Cornelia said very interesting. Cornelia? Yes. You know, when you were talking of the difference between the formality of the German language and the ease of the other, you know, I find that a lot of us who've come from the oral tradition, we use a lot of onomatopoeia, you know, dham dham, cham cham, tan tan. I mean, all these sounds evoke a particular sensorium of feelings. Now, if I translate that into English, it will firstly sound very false because English is very different and very formal in that sense. The other thing I find is that there are certain forms of expression, of literary expression, which are, which sound all wrong in the wrong language, if you know what I mean. For instance, in India, we have a very different way of looking at our ancestors and people before us, which is why biographies and memoirs in India are mostly hagiographic. Very few people have been able to master the way in which you have to put a distance between the person who you admire and whom you're writing about. The other thing, so that's one big lacuna I find. You know, we are handicapped by our own traditional ways of behavior from attempting a proper clean biography or memoir. Very few people have been able to do it. And the second is that, you know, we tend to be very flowery and descriptive because this was very much part of an epic tradition. And so when I'm translating, let's say, 5 pages of Hindi, I can often compress it into 1/2 page of English because I delete a lot of the, you know, the floweriness and the descriptions and the whatever, because it just weighs down the text. I wonder if you've ever had that experience, because you come also from a tradition where, you know, the language cultures are so different. Yes?
Yeah, definitely. Again, as I said, with maybe this exception that I don't know enough. I mean, I don't know the way you know Hindi. I don't know Somali. But one of the discussion I have with the Somali languages, which goes beyond the Republic of Djibouti, it goes to Somalia and elsewhere, is that the poetry, epic poetry tradition is now dying because no one can master, and it's becoming useless because it's too rhetorical, too flowery, as you said. You put it very beautifully. I say rhetorical. Yeah. And sometimes we now have a new genre, which is a kind of summary of from the epic poetry became songs. And so it's, as you say, maybe 5 times or 10 times smaller, and it's more direct. But this is the what we have in circulation, in videos and MP3 and so on and so forth. So the poetry became a kind of portable song writing tradition, and the whole flowering is left aside. But that is something, yeah. And what I was saying previously that I'm getting inspiration from this country, it also has to do with that, because how the multiplicity of languages and tradition became something still lively and different. And I guess many African writers should and took inspiration from Indians. I really believe
it. I'm just going to end with a broad sort of debate, which is, do you feel that being bilingual or multilingual is a blessing or a burden?
Can I ask one more question?
Sure, please.
Because I wonder, when you have a language that is almost like a singing language, which many African languages are, many Indian languages, isn't there also the problem in translation that you lose the song? So in the moment, I think we all have that problem being writers, that we put the sound into something printed and something silent. And that, I think it's what you said about that we translate the dreams and emotions. In some ways, we also translate the sound. And I think in some of languages, that's even more of a problem. And especially in the ones, for example, Indian languages, dialects often, that are so grounded still in the earth, the flowers, the nature, so connected to the natural world, that they are much more working with sound. Whereas in a language that becomes more and more intellectual, more and more distant from the natural world, loses part of their quality. And I think always as a writer, you need to try to get back to that.
No, I agree. What do you
mean? I'm sorry, I didn't get the
Isn't that, question. Well, for me the question is, how hard must it be as a translator to come from a language that still has that singing quality to then translate it into a language that may have lost that already?
Challenge, but it helps if you are completely grounded in both. Meaning, you know, my education, interestingly enough, I learned my English from German nuns, Cornelia.
Ah, interesting.
So there you are. Being a direct connection. So one has many sounds in one ear.
Yeah.
You know? It's not just our own languages, it's the languages and fragments that you get. There's something that sounds so sweet in French, for instance, or something which is so liquid about Spanish that you wish you could translate or get that rhythm into. I'm not very familiar with Chinese or Japanese, but you know, just a mere intonation, a nasal insertion can change the meaning of a word. I mean, how magical is that?
Right. I think that's the constant challenge for a translator. When you said you lose the flowers, I thought, oh, I'm sad. I wish I could read how flowery it is. Yeah. So what is on all the pages you in a way shrink down to?
No, and maybe we have to find different mediums. I mean, a novel in German may not translate directly into a novel in, let's say, Japanese. There could be a possibility of another way of dealing with it, like rap poetry. I mean, from Jamaica, the Caribbean rhythms have come into mainstream English music, or Western music, through rap, through jazz, so there are possibilities. We are still at a very nascent stage of translations. Translations are what? Just about 30, 40 years old in this country. Just imagine what they can be after a century, which is why I have great hope for, you know, young people like Mohini, who is very receptive to various sounds and inputs. And I feel that there will be a way in which we will be able to forge some kind of a lingua franca, where every sound, something in Spanish is comprehensible to me, even though I don't know Spanish.
That is true.
You know, sense impressions have to be preserved. That is what I feel.
Thank you.
So should we go back to that?
We
can have a wrap-up kind of discussion on just whether you find it limiting or liberating to be able to speak so many languages, and we can move on to audience questions. Yoko, we can start with you.
What's the
just whether you find it a blessing or a burden to be bilingual or multilingual.
Blessing, my body.
Yeah.
Oh, it's good. You know, you have many languages, but one body. So even if you speak a foreign language, you bless your mother tongue. It's accent, and it's a modify the foreign language, or you create your own. As I create my own German, and my German is not formal. My German is also not abstract. It's as full of smell and sounds. It's a primitive language, German. My German, more primitive than Asian languages, because they have many sounds in it, like the klopf and schleppen, and it's a very primitive sounds in it. Also, smell, English word is a smell, but in German, duft, it's a word itself smells. You know, it's a very direct, emotional language for me. So, but for me, each language has its private face, and it's very, we foreigners can discover it.
Yes.
It's I see the German language in other way, like as you. So it's also, it's my body that make it, make one language to another language.
Oh, Cornelia,
that was very interesting, because I think that is the privilege when you write bilingual, that you discover the other language and also discover your own language again.
Yeah.
For example, my reception of German is much better now that I live so often in English, and you sometimes have almost a yearning for the language you grew up with, which I did not feel when I lived in Germany. So, yeah, I think it's a blessing.
Both of your thoughts, and then we move on. I mean, we've talked about it a little bit, but just to say.
If I'm correct, the question was liberating or a burden.
Yeah,
it's definitely liberating. And as Yoko was saying that, I believe each and every serious writer has to make his home or her home in that language. So in my case, without being pretentious, I am trying to write something that is definitely my imprint on, and not writing the academic French or Parisian French or whatever, Saint-Germain French, what we call it, but something that is reconnaissable, as I say. This is the writer's language, French, in my case. And then, of course, it is open to all the different influences I have strive to keep in my tradition, for example, African poetry, the ways in which African have indigenized the French itself, and so on and so forth. For example, many Moroccan and North African colleagues repeat how French is liberating for them, because it was liberating from also the tradition of the limit of the tradition. For example, the whole eroticism that is sometimes repressed in a culture can flourish in French for them, for example. So it's liberating. Mm-hmm. And as for the loss of your mother tongue, I'm just practical. For example, I cannot translate into good Somali, but I also think, as Ira was saying, that it's a question of genre. You cannot translate maybe something the traditional novel into, but you can keep the oraliture of the language. For example, if I write something one day in my language, it will be only in poetry, and I will not strive to write. I will not even dream of writing a novel in my language, because this is too complicated. I will keep the flavor, the tempo of the language, but that will have something oral. But definitely, so far, my task is mastering my languages, and that is a lifetime task.
You know, we'll end with you.
You know, we talk very often about how many languages are dying, that even as we speak, a language is dead somewhere in the world. And that used to be a very sad thought for me, because you felt, oh, you've lost that, even though I didn't know the language. So much has gone away from it. But, you know, for every language lost, I find we are building more languages. I mean, look at Hinglish, which Mohini is your favorite language. I think it's a very rich marriage of two languages. And so every time we lose something, we also gain something. I like to think that we are moving in a direction where we are becoming much more accepting of other words, of other cultures, of other ways of looking and feeling. And that, I think, is what bilinguality or tri or multilinguality really ought to be doing.
Thank you. I think we can go on and on, but we're going to give the audience a chance to ask. So please identify yourselves before you ask the question. If there's any particular panelist you'd like to address, please mention that. And let's
we
keep
also
it to
keep
questions.
The questions very brief and questions, please.
Hi, I'm Kalpana Mohan. I'm a writer. Most of us learn language when we are young. So if you're bilingual or trilingual, you're typically very young when you acquire language. But Jhumpa Lahiri learned Italian as an adult, and I think in the last 6 years or so. What did you think when you read her essay written in Italian and translated by an Italian?
Who is this question addressed to?
Any one of you.
Any one of us. Would you like to? Since I think I heard your question, even though I don't know Italian or any other European language, you're right. When you are small and when you're exposed to a language, there is it's a mode of communication, really, for getting your, I want this, I want that, I don't want this, I don't like that. That is the level at which language works, at the most basic infant level. But if you acquire a language as you grow older, as Cornelia is adding language upon language to her repertoire every year, you appreciate and develop a new respect for languages which you have heard very often, but you didn't know in depth. So I think there's merit both in early exposure, so that your mind is accepting of different sounds, but more merit in acquiring a language as you grow older, because you're mature enough to understand and use it in a way that you may not be able to use it as a child. Is that what your question was?
Yes.
Thank you. There's one at the back.
Hello.
Okay.
My name is Hans. I have a question to Yoko Tawada. I read some of your books from the 1980s and 90s, and I was very impressed by the level of mastering German as a Japanese. And one thing which I remember is that you have a nice way of playing around with the German language and reflecting the German language, and also sort of pointing to the irony of how the German language is used. And now you just characterized your own language or the German language as being sensual and so on. So my question actually is, if I found that some of your books are translated into English, I saw in the bookshop here, and how do you try to say, control what is conveyed in the other third language, apart from Japanese and from German, especially from German, with this, I would say, sophistication of playing around with the German language. How can that be sort of translated by a translator, and do you try to control it? In which way?
I don't want to control the translation. I just trust the translator. But Susan Bernowski translated four books, my German books, into English, and she's a really good translator. And the communication with her, and also my French translator, I can't control the French, but you can never control, I think, the text. But they are, you know, of course I can see in the reading in the United States, when the audience are very happy about the text, you can feel it and I can control it. But the most important thing is that the translator sees a hidden opportunity in the original text, and she pull it out from the original text and create, it's not just translate, but create the new text, and that has the power to the new audience. If it is happened, I'm satisfied, so it's good enough.
Yeah, can we have that question?
Hello. My name is Lalita Iyer, and I'm a writer, and this question is to all of you. I think many of us are in this happy space where we live in an ecosystem which is rich with, you know, many languages, you know, our mother tongue, our father tongue, languages we grew up learning along the way. And I'm from such a space because I know Tamil from my mother, Malayalam from my father, English from growing up, and Hindi and Marathi, which I also speak. But I think I'm struggling with this sort of dilution of all these languages when it comes to my child. And I think many parents today are struggling with how to keep their own languages, whether it's their mother tongue or, you know, the languages they grew up speaking, because English has become such a universal leveler of sorts. And many times it's the easy way out, because it is also sometimes the language of your marriage. If you marry someone who doesn't speak the language you were born with. So I, for instance, with my son, I struggled with how to keep my mother tongue alive. So one of the things I started doing was telling him stories that I heard from my grandmother. But then all those stories were narrated in Tamil. And when I translated them to him, it just, although he enjoyed the stories, it just didn't feel the same. It just felt, I don't know, a bit sad, and I don't know what to do to keep this, to keep the languages going.
I've actually found that people who don't live in India manage to do that really well, because they're even more nostalgic about the languages that, you know, people at home speak, and they make it a point to, you know, either show them Bollywood films or speak to them at home in their language. But I mean, Kira, you should also
it is a problem, Anita. I think all of us have gone through it as parents. And I regret very much now that even though our children were exposed to a much larger palette of languages, they picked only one or two that they wanted to get on with. And their children, unfortunately, growing up abroad, are speaking just one language. So in three generations, we've lost something like five or six languages. But they are learning Spanish, they're learning French, they're learning Portuguese. So you lose some, you win some. What to do? It's a globalized world now.
There's one question at the back. Yeah. That, and there's one right in front. In the middle.
I'm audible.
Yes. Morning.
My question is that, in trying to write fictional stories, like how J.R.R. Tolkien has written Lord of the Rings, and he has created so many languages. So my question is that, does the diversity in the syntax and semantics is interdependent with the interdependent with the variability that arrives through bilingualism or trilingualism that the author has or the creator has.
You mean to say when you're creating a new language, say in a fantasy novel or something, does it depend on the variability of the languages that you know already? Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm looking at you.
I'm not creating languages. Tolkien was a specialist in Nordic languages and quite fluent in them. And I think he based his fictional languages on old Finnish and Norwegian dialects. So I think you cannot fully, even if you try to invent something, and that is, I think, true for all fantasy, it is always fed by everything, by our world, because we cannot imagine anything that is not from this world.
Thank you. There's one right there.
Hi, I'm Sandra, and I have a question for Cornelia. You said you change when you speak Italian or English, and I wanted to ask, do you feel the same for your heroes? Yeah, like, do you feel like Jacob sounds different, maybe, I don't know, more dashing in English than he would sound in German or in Italian or in Spanish?
It does. I hear sometimes from actors that they can barely go to a movie theater where they talk suddenly in another tongue and they have to leave laughing their heads off because they suddenly sound so strange speaking Spanish. I love, and I asked for a while, all my translators to send me a page read in their language of their translations so that I could at least hear what my story sounds like in another language. Mm-hmm. I think I'm translated into 43 languages or something. So for a while I collected those voices and it almost feels as if your story each time wears another costume, another clothes. And I always feel I learned something new about my characters, which I clearly did not know. And you are absolutely right. For example, when I read from Mirrorworld and I read about Jacob, I never know, should I call him Jakob? In a German way, or should I could call him Jacob because he was born in America in my novel? I'm never quite sure how they change, but they definitely do.
That's beautiful.
They sound very different in French.
Jacob. I think Jacob. We'll have to wrap up now. Can we have a last question? Okay, I think we'll have to wrap up now. So thank you everyone for being here for the discussion. Thank you panelists. I really enjoyed talking to all of you.
Thank you very much.
And everyone's books are available outside, so please get your copies and get them signed. Thank you.
Yes, we wish to thank our speakers, Yoko Tawada, Cornelia Funke, Abdurrahman Waberi, Ira Pandey and Mohini Gupta. We also would like to thank our sponsor, the Rajasthan Patrika series, for this session. The authors will be available to sign the books, so grab your copy, and the book signing area is right outside on your left. Thank you. We begin our next session in about 10 minutes. Why Inks Matter at Betak? Elsewhere we have The Craft of the Bestseller, The Fry Chronicles at the Rajnigandha Silver Pearls Front Lawns, Ramcharitmanas, The Life of a Text at Google Mughal Tent, Surrogate Lives at Mahindra Humanities Darbar Center, The Making of a Superhero at Fort Samvad.
जीवन जीने का तरीका है अपनी भाषा को इज्जत देना अपने वजूद को सम्मान देने जैसा है हिंदुस्तान की सैकड़ों भाषाएं हिंदी में शामिल हैं इसलिए हमेशा से सबकी पसंदीदा है देश के सबसे बड़े हिंदी अखबारों में एक है पत्रिका उत्तर भारत से लेकर पूर्व पश्चिम दक्षिण तक सबके दिलों में बसा है आज राजस्थान पत्रिका केवल अखबार नहीं रेडियो टीवी मोबाइल इंटरनेट और अन्य साधनों से लोगों की बात उठाता है लोगों को जीतना है तो उनके दिल जीत कर देखिए हिंदी पढ़िए और हिंदी बोलिए राजस्थान पत्रिका देश का प्रमुख समाचार पत्र समूह
tweet to win. Are you tweeting? Tweet with hashtag ZJLF and get a chance to win exciting prizes from JLF. More you tweet, the more points you get. Top 10 tweeters would get prizes by the end of each day. For more details, visit the information center. We also have our festival merchandise on sale online as well as at the festival bookshop near Charbagh. Brochures are on sale at the information desk. We would also like to let you know, session number 88A, Literature versus Cinema, Influence in Shaping Beauty Ideals, is moved from Baithak and it is now going to take place at Google Mughal Tent from 2:30 to 3:30. The session, Negro Land at Mughal Tent, Google Mughal Tent, it stands cancelled. Negro Land stands cancelled, and in that place we have Literature versus Cinema, Influence in Shaping Beauty Ideals. That has moved to Google Mughal Tent from 12:30. It is now going to take place at 2:30. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will start in a few minutes with the next session, Why Ancients Matter. And I just wanted to let you know that all the authors will be ready for book signing after this session. So if you want to grab a copy of their books, you can just run to the bookshop quickly, get one of the copies, and then they will be available at the book signing.